Welcome back, everybody, to the exciting conclusion of Chapter 11 with yours truly, Reading Wonderland, The Mask and the Maiden, written by A.S. Hunt, read by yours truly, Freewata, with the exclamation point for the added emphasis. I'm just so excited. I'm literally picking this up. I have just a little bit more time before this class I'm taking starts. Just enough time to get this chapter read and out. I couldn't just stop here because Faye just murked Dina for the potentially second time. The first time, you know, she didn't know it wasn't Dina that she murked. And now the second time, she actually murked her that we know of. If she's not dead, if maybe she's not dead somehow still. You know, rapier is a pokey weapon. So maybe it didn't hit any, well, it is Faye too, but as a Parok Faye. So does Parok Faye know where to hit the vital organs with a rapier like Faye did? I don't know. So we'll figure out what happens in the final part. No, cried Austin frantically, trying to get close. Knowing how dangerous the woman was, Faye, this isn't you, it's the Parok. I can help you and it's not too late. Please. Please come to your senses. Faye continued to ignore him as Ashley rolled to get up and throw herself at the woman, crying and beating her in the chest. Faye seemed to not budge until she reared back her gloved fist and punched Ashley in the face. Die, you stupid home bitch, die. But Ashley was unfazed and mimicked Faye's movement, hitting her squarely in the nose before she could do anything else. It bloodied. The woman's expression almost twisted into rage, then went back to an eerie, insane grin.
Why? Asked the girl, sick and tired of crying and being said, why are you doing this now?
Then she noticed for the first time the woman's left eye covered in the whitish Parok mold.
No, whispered Ashley. You're not one of them now, are you?
The Bandersnatch bellowed, getting everyone's attention and struggled into getting to its feet. It voiced, bow. It seemed to say, and then turned back to the wall and lumbered back the way it came. Faye turned her attention back to Ashley and lunged with her rapier, stabbing Ashley, who swung out of the way, nearly falling back.
You can't be this thing now, you can't.
I can help her, cried Austin, but Ashley didn't regard him. She hoped beyond hope that he was talking about Dina. Dina. She remembered. No, they was this thing. You killed half the maids in Tempanemus on order and threw them on a table for me to bleed, to use for painting.
You really are a monster, she said quietly, with or without the Parok. Now you're just whole.
Faye seemed to flinch. You'll die, she said mindlessly, flailing her rapier about. It was completely unlike the dance Ashley witnessed at Lacey Vale. Outside the prison, the woman was unfocused. Not herself. The Parok making a mockery of her. Ashley leapt back again, the tip of the blade this time missing her by centimeters.
I can't fucking believe it, said Ashley. You were almost my friend.
Faye flinched again. Ashley, keep at her. Wear her down, said Austin. We might bring her back. Ashley threw herself at Faye again and hit her in the side and threw another punch, only to have her hand caught by the woman. She was thrown to the ground but rolled instinctively just as Faye's rapier plunged into the earth where she was. The woman quickly dislodged it and swung at the girl, missing again and again.
I can't fight her, said Ashley.
She's too much, too strong, even under the influence of the Parok, and no sign of slowing. Slashing again and again while Ashley slowly began to tire beyond the exasperation with which she had awoken. And Austin wasn't doing a damn thing but telling her to keep it up. And Omna had been a dream all the while, never anyone who could really save her. She looked all over the courtyard as she fled the woman. It was just them. The beast had thundered back into this hellhole, leaving only a muddied, rocky trail without bleeding. And Dina was dead, or near it, still twitching. There were no automatons, no mad, No maids, no guards, no one but Faye and Austin and her. No hope. Faye caught her, grabbing her by the neck and lifting her up with a single arm. The Parak were amplifying her strength and threw her down once more near a huge rock in the courtyard. It was very nearly over. Elise thought Ashley as she rolled onto her back to face her tormentor. She wasn't leaving the world falling. Stupid, 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 repeated Faye over and over. She held her rapier back, then shoved it into Ashley's chest. Fucking hell, shouted Austin. You can't, Faye. You can't. Ashley! The wind went on softly, as it had throughout the day. Wind through the trees could be heard faintly. The second sun was in its pulsing state, as happened every few moons. The growth of fungi increased in response, while flora decayed at the exposure of its light. Though the light of the first sun still prevailed in the season, the grass was permanently stunted because of its breed. It never grew more than aesthetically pleasing. Clouds were sparing, providing moving shadows to accentuate the land here and there, just enough. It was a beautiful day. Austin watched Faye draw back and shove the rapier again and again at Ashley's body, shrieking with each thrust, then senselessly slashing. Austin had gone hoarse yelling to stop her, frozen to the spot, understanding it was too late. The girl was doomed to the slaughter. Faye screamed once more, then nearly doubled over in one more shove of her weapon, which made a most unusual noise. Ashley opened her eyes. Faye stared, the look of rage rising and falling in rapid succession, her fist shaking. The tip of the rapier had shattered against Ashley's skin. The girl gasped. She never really realized it, never thought about it in this twisted, surreal on and off hell. She'd kept making excuses, never imagining it could be real. But despite the torment her mind and heart had been through, despite all that had happened to her, despite the deafening fury and Faye's attack and her screaming, her weapon hitting every time she shoved or swung or stabbed, Ashley's skin never broke. The rapier colliding and bouncing off or sliding away. She had never broken. Never really been hurt. Impossibly she was vulnerable. She was alive.
I need help, she said softly, to the Fates in particular.
The dress that Ashley wore as mistress had been ripped out of when she grew after putting on the mask. It lay still and tattered across the courtyard. It was a sudden thing for the cards that had lain dormant in her dress pocket to flash brightly and come flying at her, placing themselves five very neatly into her hand, all glowing and ready to be used, telling her to use them. Girl hadn't expected it. She knew it. They were her weapon now. Faye had been taken aback, caught off guard, but tossed the rapier aside in the dirt and pulled a dirk from a sheath in her belt. This was made for cutting just as well as stabbing, and she started in on another assault at the girl, who quickly drew one of the cards at random and placed it out in front of her. Ashley was enveloped quickly in a green light. Parak Faye held her attack, clenching her jaw, too mindless to expect anything. Austin watched in awe as Ashley's clothing disappeared from the ground and appeared on her body. Gauze and all, ripped and torn in places but fitting better than Austin's loose coat, which appeared back by Dina. Faye watched the girl as Ashley looked at herself, remembering the ribbon she'd worn to make her not care. It was noticeably absent. What is going on? Said Austin quietly. Why does she have those? How could she? Ashley drew another card, but Faye stabbed at her hand before she could place it between them. Ashley pulled back instinctively, but the blade made contact, and she could see once again Faye had not cut her, nor broke her skin, nor bruised her.
You can't hurt me, said Ashley in wonder at this fact. But I'm going to hurt you.
She shoved the woman, who was once again dumbfounded with not being able to kill the girl or cut off her limbs. Faye fell back, Her look had changed only slightly. Lurking on her face was an awareness, a semblance of learning. Ashley threw the next card forcibly between them. The card flashed and transformed into an arrow, shooting forward and knocking the woman back at point blank. It hadn't pierced her armor, but instead enveloped her in a green flame. The Baroness threw down her dirk and took off her armor before rolling on the ground, yelling unintelligibly. Ashley might actually be winning, thought Austin. How could it be? How could a slave girl with no memory come into possession of such cards? How could she even be alive? The mask given her something? Something to keep? Or had she always had it? Ashley drew another card at Faye, who had smothered the weak flames. The card flashed and threw itself at Ashley's feet, which she recognized as the silent footfall.
Gods, said Ashley, I don't need that one.
The woman grinned and stepped forward.
Stupid hom can't be stabbed, be cut, maybe, but the neck be broken?
The voice was not her own. They were the familiar hive mind Ashley knew had been lurking and growing in the ravine. Horrible fungus that took people's minds before they took their lives. She drew another card before Faye could get too close, and this time the daylight seemed to blink. There was an absence of all light for a moment, and then Faye was clutching at her eyes. Ashley had few cards left. What was that one? Blindness? Ashley looked to Austin, who was also blinking and rubbing his eyes.
I can't see, he said.
The effect couldn't last long, Ashley thought. She drew another card. The woman was clawing at the Perak mold on her face. There was a simultaneous glimmer of hope and repulsion. But did she really kill Dina? Or was it the Perak? She was going to kill her. The first time. Ashley slammed the card down in front of her, and the sound of thunder shook the castle mansion as it landed, loud and cracking. The woman's senses had been stunned. It was time for something more direct. Ashley lifted a stone with exertion. She was somehow impervious to select attacks, but not stronger in the least, and ran at Faye with it, lifting it high and striking her head, aiming for the mold spores. The Baroness cried out as she fell, but got up again, bleeding and angry.
You can't hurt us. You can't kill us, said the Perak Faye.
Ashley turned to run and rethink her process, but Faye was charging at her. The next card produced a glowing key, which began to shoot towards Faye, but disappeared. There'd been no lock to negotiate.
Damn it, cursed Ashley.
Learning to read was her first goal if they made it out of this alive. Faye laughed maniacally as she tackled the girl to the ground, knocking the air and orientation out of her. That hadn't hurt, thought Ashley, but it didn't feel good. The woman straddled her and began hitting her face. Left, right, laughing all the while.
Stop! Yelled Austin again to no avail. Might as well be sleeping. I'm useless.
He charged at the woman who hadn't yet taken notice of him and shoved her off the girl. Ashley shot up and drew another card, completely unfazed. Faye wasted no time in running around the energy field that was created, or tried to, but it grew too large, covering Ashley and brushing Austin and Faye back several meters.
This isn't working, said Ashley,
glad to at least have the enemy at a distance.
Austin, I can't read these. I need your help.
The force field stopped growing and the girl was in a bubble of sorts. Austin hesitantly found he could enter. Faye stood her ground, watching them, unsure of how to attack next.
Austin, I don't know what to do, Ashley pleaded. Tell me what this one says.
Austin looked at the card, keeping an eye on Faye.
Heal. It says heal. And this one. Hurry.
The force field was shrinking. Faye was eyeing Austin now. There was no sign that she knew or remembered him. Total cleanse, he said, not understanding.
I don't know what they mean, though.
The woman was pounding away at the force field with the same rock Ashley had used to strike her.
Going to try crushing your heads, Homs?
She, or it, said.
Try crush. Crunch. Skull of home. Eat skull of home.
Please, Faye, begged Austin. Stop. Come to your senses. Ashley pocketed the healing card and threw total cleanse in front of her, and a bolt of lightning appeared to fly from the card and Ashley to Faye. striking her in the chest and slapping her violently against the large rock in the courtyard after she spun numerous times in flight. She fell to the ground and was still.
What the hell is total cleanse?
Demanded Austin, sounding accusatory.
Ashley, don't kill her. We can still save her. Why would you want to?
Exclaimed the girl with equal tone and started towards Faye's crumpled body. The woman could be heard moaning slightly. It was guttered. It was guttural. She had finally been neutralized. Ashley regarded her.
You are finally afraid now, said the girl coldly. You'd have killed me and my friend and not thought twice about it. You were going to sell me to that monster and you've killed my friend after all.
She'd felt righteous in punishing the woman, victorious even now that she stood over her. But her tears pelted the ground the same. Nothing was going to make any of it better.
Shh,
started the Baroness. Austin came to her side, helping her up. She pushed him away and stood on her own.
Monster,
she said, staring at the ground. They could see that the proc had burned away, replacing the whitish mold with scarred and burned skin tissue. Her eye had been consumed.
Monster,
she repeated, looking at the girl without expression.
Yes, I am a monster. I was Faye, the last Baroness of the House of Katarina. That's what I've been hanging on to for the grand cycles I've been here, following you.
She looked at Austin now and her eyes welled up.
You haven't aged at all, Austin.
The young hom returned her gaze, and Ashley could see there was a connection. Had been. For who knew how long? Something she couldn't fathom.
You killed Dina,
she said to the woman.
I didn't. That wasn't me. It doesn't matter. You would have anyway. Those were orders, girl. It was always for the Lord of Teponemus. You would come to understand that too, someday. Die for the master, is that it?
That's enough, said Austin.
Faye, I'm sorry, Save me your apologies, interrupted the woman. I can't anymore.
Austin nodded. The Baroness started towards her broken rapier and picked it up.
What's of the beast?
The girl injured it when she wore the mask, said Austin. It's going to be, well, as fine as it ever will be. Let's head back to the ravine.
I'm home to Mamurg,
replied Faye quietly. She continued on until she came across the young Grimalkin female on the ground, laying in blood.
This one is still alive, she said without turning.
Say your goodbyes or do what you wish. Ashley ran to Dina and knelt, while Austin watched Faye limp, weak again, now that her body had been used by the Parak, and she was left without the support across the courtyard to the wall.
I'm to the springs. Was my way in here?
It'll be my way out. Austin started to her.
Faye, why are you leaving?
Unfinished business, she said at her distance, not caring if anyone heard her. She turned to them. Hurt to lay eyes on Austin.
Ashley, she called to the girl. I'm sorry for your friend, but you're right. Right all along. You're a who until you're a what, girl.
I'm a monster. With that, she turned away from the speechless girl, and when she started walking, she did not stop again, but called again.
Thank you for showing me what I truly am.
Austin called after her again, pleading her to return, but she continued on until she'd cleared the crushed portion of the hedge maze and was out of sight. Ashley clutched the heel card, focused on her friend. She could still see her breathing.
Please, please, please work, she begged the card. You have to.
She drew it, slamming on the invisible surface, and it glowed like hot coals over the younger girl. Then it stopped, and all of the cards flew back to Ashley's hand. The meters on the sides depleted. She looked at them for a moment and placed them in the pocket on the dress. Hadn't worked.
I'm sorry, said the girl.
That was it. The wind still gently blew. The light of the first sun still hadn't been bested by the second sun's fungi-growing shine. The trees still waved gently, peacefully. Ashley imagined Mus running about playing in the hedge maze. Then she imagined them getting violently torn apart by vespers, eaten. Their corpses played with until their entrails were strewn throughout the greens. The vespers laughing and snarling at each other until the ground opened up and the plant creature ate them whole. And she imagined the plant creature sucking the meat off their bones and throwing them back up. It was a beautiful day, but absent hope. As though there had never been any at all. There's never been any hope, she thought absently. And the thought turned white and filled her with but instead of filling the void, it became the void. And then Dina coughed.
Dina,
yelped Ashley. She couldn't believe it. Had the card worked after all? Austin ran to her side. Her wound is closed, he said after checking her back. It's scarred over, even. I didn't know this magic existed. Dina squirmed and groaned. It hurts, she whined.
We're going to help you, said Ashley excitedly. Can you move?
Her wounds are closed, but she still feels the pain, said Austin. Given the entry and exit point, I think her lung was punctured through. She had numerous other bruises and cuts, too, but they seem to be gone.
What do we do?
Demanded Ashley, with an authority that nearly made Austin believe the queen had possessed her. We need to get her water to get her in the castle. They helped the Grimalkin up and walked her in after Austin gave her fountain water, neither feeling up to talking about anything at all until the girl had been hydrated. Looked over by the former mad, laid to rest for the day. Austin found Ashley sitting at the grand table in the courtyard that evening. In the towns, the second sun was sending people home from their late jobs, providing the last natural light and form of protection against predators. It was waving goodbye to the first moon, which had been hard at work for a short while now, and the second moon, just now peeping over the horizon. It would make its journey more quickly across the sky than the first, moving more around it than passing it directly. And it'd be long gone before the first sun's light shone again. Ashley had found herself pondering the motions of the stars as well. They didn't stay in the same place. The brightest one used to be just north of the castle. Now it was to the south and east, and just a little further out than it had been. She knew somehow that when the first sun came back, it would be said that a cycle had passed, and when the light of the first sun had waned completely from the first moon and then returned to it, a moon was said to have passed. There was comfort to this remembered knowledge, relaxed but perplexed, or perhaps relaxed because she was perplexed. The girl lied back on the bench, seating, and closed her eyes. Austin watched her as perplexed yet relaxed for some time. At length, he approached her with a cup of tea, lightly, so as not to startle her. I've made you tea, he said. The girl opened her eyes and got up, watching him. If you trust me, he said.
I do, replied Ashley. I'm not sure why. Maybe because we share something now. It's because of the mask.
We don't quite have the same insight on each other, remarked Austin. His tone was flat but soft. She wanted to hear him speak more. The allure of the mad had worn off on her, maybe. Or maybe it had remanifested itself in new form. Or maybe it was just the mask all along. But she decided she liked him well enough anyway. You have your perception of me now because you basically felt me, he said, placing the cup in front of her. But I have mine of you from watching you, from behind the eyes of the mask.
I trust you, she repeated, because I know you. Somehow I don't even have to ask if you and the mad are the same.
Ashley, we are.
You're not. She persisted. You and whatever is in there, you're not the same. I knew you didn't have the same experience as me, somehow, but you were bound and chained all the same. You were a slave.
No, said Austin quietly. I chose to put on the mask, and I shall do it again, because I have to. Ashley could not find words to respond to this, so she sat quietly while her heart calmed down and drank her tea. Time passed and the two sat in silence, listening to the breeze.
Why? Started Ashley. I'm not quite sure I'm able-minded enough now to explain it all properly, said Austin. I think it would be best to make sure the mask isn't damaged.
How would you know?
It will be apparent after I put it on, said Austin. Every moment the Mat isn't planning a contingency, they get closer to... He stopped. I'm sorry. I really shouldn't be weighing you down with this. You've been through quite enough already. He got up from the table and started towards the castle mansion entrance. Whatever happens, I'm confident the Mad won't bother you this time. Now Ashley stood up, but Austin raised his hand. You and your friend will be the proximity, he continued. I know you can't understand it, but Faye was the last proximity, and he let her alone, you see?
I'm not going to be the damned Baroness, cried the girl.
It's the only way, said Austin, walking off, because you have to stay until your friend gets better. Then you can leave if you wish. He'd said it coldly, and Ashley would have wondered if Austin and the Mad really were the same after all. But she'd seen the vision that the mask showed her. She knew what would have been. He had to know.
You can't do this, she called after him. I know you can't.
But he continued on, and she was forced to give chase while the cycle of the moons and stars continued to shift, the light dancing across the sharing shadows and fighting for dominance, knowing it could never have it. And that, my friends, was the end of chapter 11. Well, no one died yet, still. Oh my gosh. What a climax, dude. What a climax. That's just, I don't know. I feel like that's something you can't get in the pop culture world of reading, you know? Like, I'm sure you can get twists and turns and all that fun stuff. But as far as like just something that's so bitter to the taste, something that leaves you just completely empty, but you've gotten everything. Like, nothing's technically that bad in the end. Everyone could have died and it could all been over, or everyone could have lived and they could all been happy. But instead we've got this like middle ground area where everyone is alive, but no one is happy. You know, no one's happy with the result. Like, almost being alive for this book is more torment than those who have passed on, you know, from earlier stage. So like our Aethids and our Naloris, you know, our other different mistresses, or the I guess the slaves of the Mad and stuff like that that had gotten killed, like that was one and done, you know. They're out. They don't have to worry about this anymore. But Ashley, she's got everything back to normal in her hands technically, but still nothing's going right. So let me know y'all's thoughts on that again. What y'all think about this and how this is going. What do you think this last chapter holds in store for us? Because I just want to make sure you guys stay beautiful and stay hydrated, and we will see you in the final chapter.